I would like to introduce our first speaker today, who is Dr. Jody Gangloff-Kaufmann. Jody is the coordinator of the community IPM program at Cornell University, and she will be speaking today on how to get rid of pantry moths. So Jody, you can take it away.
Okay. Are you seeing my slide, my first slide?
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, I see that there are a number of people here. Can you, everyone in the chat, just tell me whether or not you've ever had pantry moths in your home? Even if you haven't, say no. If you have, please just say yes. Just curious about how common this problem is. And I'm curious because I've had pantry moths in my house as a basis for this talk. A lot of these pictures are my pictures. So I'm going to tell you, you know, how to get rid of pantry moths and talk a little bit about related species. Stored product arthropod pests are problematic worldwide. So, you know, because we move goods all around the globe, we share these kind of pests that are, you know, throughout the food system. And I say arthropod because rodents are a big part of the problems, you know, in food around the world. But when talking about arthropods, beetles and weevils, which are a type of beetle, and moths and mites kind of dominate the pest, stored product pest world here. And they consume anything that's sort of dry and nutritious. So grains and nuts, cereal, pasta, cheese, preserved meats. So that would be, you know, dried meats and jerky and stuff. And they also consume wool and leather, which are a little different, but still nutritious if you can digest it. And stored product arthropod pests are responsible for about 20% of the world's grain supply being destroyed. And that's a huge amount of food. So these are serious pests, and they're not just pests of industrial settings and farms, they are pests of the home as well. So we're gonna focus on the moths. So what is a pantry moth versus, you know, other moths? Here we have a beautiful silk moth of North America. Now moths are really successful. There are 12,000 or so species in North America, in the United States. And compare that with the number of butterflies, it's only about 825 species. So moths are really successful and quite diverse and really essential to their ecological systems. Pantry moths versus other moths. Pantry moths are simply moths that as larvae affect or infest or feed on food items that we aggregate, like grains, dried fruit, you know, pet food, which is highly processed usually, dry pet food, and seeds. So we gather this stuff together normally in their environments. They would eat these kinds of things out in the world, grains or seeds. But when we put it all together, they become pests. They compete with us for that resource and they destroy, our foodstuffs. So the four most common types of moths are these. So the Indian meal moth, it's one of the most common, it's worldwide. It has a very general diet. It has a pretty long lifespan. The adults can live the whole lifespan could be up to 60 days. And they lay a prolific number of eggs. The Angoumois grain moth, I love that word. That is a region in France that is no longer, but Angoumois grain moths affect whole grains and seeds. And the larvae will tunnel inside a seed and feed from the inside out. They have a similar lifespan. And we've had them come into our office. The almond moth is a pest of dried fruits and nuts, and it's common on the West Coast where most of the almonds are grown in the United States. And then the Mediterranean grain moth, all of these species are worldwide. Mediterranean grain moth and almond moth are often confused just by their looks, but they're not as common as the Indian meal moth, which is really, it has the fastest life cycle, it has a high reproductive capacity, and it can survive outside. So this is the one generally people find in their homes. Well, we don't want to confuse them with clothing moths because there are other types of, house infesting moths that you might see. Here we have a case-making clothes moth and a webbing clothes moth. And really, what's the difference? Just, it's a species difference, but they exist in the same niche. They feed on keratin-based fibers. So, you know, anything made of animal fur, wool, you know, that kind of nutritious, if you can digest it, material. And you'll see here the larva that's encased in a little fur coat, it looks like, right? So larvae will create these tunnels or these casings to live in, and it protects them from dehydration and from predation. And they, you know, they can destroy all the clothing and or rugs and anything made of wool in your home. How do you tell the difference though? How do you tell the difference? Well, here's an angoumois grain moth versus a webbing clothes moth. And there are subtle differences here, but you know, in general, they look very similar. And you would need a microscope because these are tiny. They're less than half an inch long. But there are some morphological differences. And you can see the little fancy fringes on the webbing clothes moth, which makes, you know, makes a difference if you're looking at it under a microscope. There's also a shape of the hind wing in the angoumois grain moth. So if you need help identifying a moth that you find indoors, you have a cooperative extension, you have the New York State IPM program to take a look and give you advice, but you also can just, you know, look around your house and try to find the source. Now, here's another stored grain moth that can be found indoors. This one is the, I call it the Pyralis meal moth. It's called the meal moth, but the Pyralis is the genus name. It's found worldwide, but it's really common in the Northeast for some reason. It's a larger moth. It has about a 1-inch wingspan, and the larvae can be up to 1 inch long. These are pests of milled plant products and grains. You often find them in pet stores or associated with Timothy hay for pets. And I can speak from experience that we had Timothy hay for the tortoise in the basement, and suddenly an outbreak of these cute little moths. And I've had a pest control professional come to me and say, what are these? We've had them in a different home. So they can, you know, become pests of the home simply because you brought in, you know, Halloween decorations or fall, you know, decorations and or Timothy hay for various pets. They are also the main ingredient in a Chinese tea, I've come to learn. And that is not the insect itself, but the insect frass, because these and other insects feed on specific plants. Then the plant material is the frass or the leftovers after they're done, and that has medicinal properties. So that's an interesting aspect to a meal moth like this, a pest. Now, related but not a food pest are the grass moths. These are also pyralid moths. These include sod webworms, which is a complex of many species and can cause damage in your turf grass. But you might find these indoors just accidentally. So it's good to know the difference. If you're worried about a moth like this, you can have it identified, as I said. But these will not damage food products indoors. So it's a pantry moth. You know, what do you do? What's next? Where do they come from? How did it get inside if it's really a true pantry moth? Some of the moths that invade our homes actually live in the outdoor environment. So Indian meal moth is one example. I introduced Indian meal moth into my home with beekeeping equipment. So they got into the equipment, they came into my house. I do not have cold storage for those pieces of equipment. So now I have moths occasionally. So they usually come into a home via infested food products from stores. The lower volume of sales that a store may do, say a privately owned, not a corporate pet food store, or a little grocery or something like that, where first in, first out might not be, you know, followed those rules, you might end up with contaminated products from a store like that. And it's not unheard of to have larger stores have infested food products, because these will affect food products all along the food production chain. So this is how they normally get into homes though. And what's interesting is that they can persist because when the larvae complete development in that food source, they will crawl away from the food source and pupate in a hidden gap, in a crack, along shelving or other places. And those can be very hard to find. So even if you've cleaned out, thrown away something that was infested, those larvae turn into pupae, become adults, you know, weeks later, And those adults, you may or may not notice them, can reinfest products that are still in the cabinet. The larvae will survive also on tiny amounts of food residue. So if there are crumbs or anything else in the, you know, anywhere in the gaps of the cabinet or something, these can, you know, survive and start the cycle all over again. But the packages were sealed. I got clean, nice packages from the store. Yeah, so adult moths will lay eggs in exposed food for sure. And they'll lay eggs near packaged foods, but they also lay their eggs along jar lids and in the folds of plastic packaging. And what's amazing is that a larvae at the youngest stage can wiggle their way right under jar lids. Think of, you know, a jar of pasta sauce, and, you know, it's vacuum sealed. So when you open pasta sauce, you know, it's, you know, it's not contaminated. But sometimes those jars are useful to reuse to you know, keep grains in, and those lids become loose. So that is a good example of where larvae can wiggle right under. And they can also chew through plastic wrapping in packages. So they'll get underneath the cardboard and into that cereal box and chew right through the package into, you know, your cereal. And then products like boil in bag rice is, it's just an invitation for stored product pests, not just these, you know, moth pests, but also beetles, sawtooth grain beetles, things like that. So, so I try to avoid boil in bag type products anyway. So what's to do? What are you going to do? Are insecticides the answer here? You know, no, we're not going to be spraying our cabinets and our kitchen areas and pantry and, you know, pet food spaces with pesticides for this pest. We're going to use true IPM. We start with inspection. Pull out everything in the cabinet if you have a moth in that cabinet and inspect every item, looking for larvae and for the feeding and frass. So that raisin box has lots of tiny pellets of frass, and you can see damage to at least a couple of those raisins. And, you know, that's pretty happy feeding right there. And then also packages may have webbing. You might not see adults or larvae, but you'll see the webbing. So holding that up to the light, if there are grains that are sort of attached to the side of the package, that looks like webbing. And those are definite signs of pantry moths. And what we want to do is discard all of that stuff. You can throw it outside for the birds, or, you know, just throw it in the garbage, but get rid of it in order to get rid of the moths. And inspect all dry goods and containers for evidence of moths. Any products like this should be thrown away. Don't try to scoop out what you see, because they can destroy the flavor or cause distaste in food. So you don't want to, like, you know, try to salvage anything like this. Just discard it. And I find that breadcrumbs are particularly vulnerable, because if, you know, the paper jar and the plastic lid, it's very loose. So try to buy smaller, if you have this problem, buy smaller containers of breadcrumbs and buy them more often, so that you do not have containers sitting around waiting for contamination. And another option is to, when you've cleaned out things and you find items that are not compromised, that the bag of your lentils is still intact and airtight, freeze that bag. Freeze any uncontaminated products to kill the eggs and larvae on the outside of the package. Take a week and put those things in the freezer, and they will be fine. And then try to remember to use them first in, first out, to maintain a moth-free cabinet and pantry. Now, after removing the contents of the cabinet, you want to vacuum and wash all these surfaces, obviously, but also think about the shelving. If you have adjustable shelving and the little holes that, you know, the pegs go in to move the shelving around, you want to lift that shelving out and clean around the edges and clean the walls around those edges, because that is where you'll find larvae pupating in little silken tubes. Get a moth-safe food storage system. You want to have jars that have like a rubber gasket, and mason jars are great because that rubber gasket can be airtight, and that will preserve not only the freshness of your food, but also prevent it from becoming contaminated with moths. You know, even cereal in packages can be stored like this, and it'll just stay fresher longer. So we encourage this kind of thing. And if you buy in bulk, you're going to need packages or containers like this. Now, moth traps are a really popular item and easy to use. Now, pheromones are considered pesticides, but these are available for homeowners to use. The trick with moth traps and any pheromone trap is to use only one trap in a given space. So maybe one trap in this room, the kitchen, maybe one more in a pantry if you have a separate closed pantry, because if you flood the area with pheromones, the males, which this is what happens, the males track females because the females release pheromones. So in these traps, you're only catching males. If they can't follow a plume to the trap or to the female, they're going to be confused and they're not going to get in your traps or be trapped. So imagine a female moth emits the tiniest amount of pheromone, and these traps emit a lot more than that. So when you use moth traps, use them sparingly and leave them out for the amount of time it says on the package. It's 1 or 3 months, and then discard them and renew them. You're going to use these for monitoring. They're not going to solve a moth problem because they're not catching the females. But this will tell you if your efforts of cleaning and sorting and organizing and discarding food is effective, if it's working, and or if you see a resurgence of moths in your home. Now, that's pretty much my message, but I want to say, remember that moths can disappear from your view for months, maybe over the winter time, and then they will reappear when you least expect it. And that is because, as I said, they can go into sort of hiding. They can persist on small amounts of food out of your view, and then appear because a female laid a whole bunch of eggs, brand new eggs, on some product that you have now brought into the home. Or maybe you're getting something from a store that is contaminated and you're reinfesting the home. These moths can be seasonal. They're certainly more active in the warmer months, and use those pheromone traps to actively monitor if you've had, moths in your home. So if you have been answering me in the chat, whether or not you've had pantry moths, I'd also like to know if you will change anything about your moth control with this presentation. And there's more information if you want to use your phone and look at that QR code. That brings you right to our Pantry Pests webpage in What's Bugging You. So there.
Thank you for a great presentation, Jody. I just want to say that I like the emphasis that you placed on identifying the larvae, because in many cases, people see the visible stage of the pest, which is the moth flying around, but they don't necessarily tie that back to the larvae, which is doing the damage and at the breeding site. So that's a really good emphasis for people to consider. We will switch over now to our IPM Minute. And for this, we're taking a quick snapshot at something that is timely for this part of the year, and that is ticks. So today we will hear from Joellen Lampman, and she is our school and turf grass IPM specialist. And today she'll be talking about adult ticks are out for blood and how you can avoid them. Take it away, Joellen.
Thanks a lot, Matt. As Matt says, he asked me to talk about adult ticks. However, just 2 days ago, I received a phone call from a colleague that was covered with ticks. What do I do? So I had recommended the duct tape method to get all of these Asian longhorn tick larvae off of her. And I have a quick video here just to show how incredibly small these things are. It's trying unsuccessfully to hide behind a hair, but that's a pretty close thing. It's maybe 6 times the width of a hair. So we're not only looking for the adults, which are much easier to see. They're about the size of poppy seeds. I'm sorry, they're the size of apple seeds, but we're also looking for those really tiny larvae. So it's October. What are we going to see? Well, we are mostly going to see black-legged ticks, and we're mostly going to see that they're adult size. They emerge at about the same time that the deer start thinking about mating. So now is the time we really need to be cautious of those. We're also going to see black-legged tick larvae. These are the ones that hatched out in July and August. And if they haven't found something to feed on, they're going to keep looking until we get into the really cold weather. And because it's been such a wet summer, we are also seeing those poppy seed-sized nymphs that were very active in the spring. Now that it's getting if they haven't found something to feed on, we're going to see them as well. There are lone star ticks, nymphs, the Asian longhorn tick larva, as I pointed out. And we now know that we have Gulf Coast ticks in New York. There's only two locations at this point, but if they're there, what is active right now are the adults and the larva. And it matters because all of these ticks carry different disease-causing pathogens, which is why we worry about it. So this information comes from a Tick Encounter. They have a citizen science project, tick spotters, and this is kind of what they laid out all fall is going to be. So as we leave October, we go into November, we're going to see certain tick species drop off in different life stages, but we are stuck with the adult black-legged ticks all through fall, all through the winter and going into the spring. If they haven't found something to feed on, they're going to keep looking. So what are we going to do about it? Well, I am really enamored by this Swiss cheese model because I believe that this shows us that there are lots of steps that we can take to protect ourselves, but none of them are going to work 100% of the time. So the more protective strategies that we put into place, the less likely it is that a tick is going to reach skin, be able to embed, and start to feed on our blood. So I have time to cover just two today. So first one, dress the part, and I feel so much more confident making this recommendation now than I did the last few months when it was really steamy hot, because now it feels good to put on that pair of pants and nice thick socks that are out there. But make sure you do take your pants and tuck them into your socks and tuck your shirt in, because what we want is for the ticks to not be able to reach skin, so that if they get on you below your knee, they're crawling up. If everything is tucked in, it's not until they reach your neck area that they're going to reach skin, be able to embed, be able to feed and pass along those pathogens. If it's light colored clothing and we kind of look at ourselves as we're out and about, we also might see them crawling up us. So dressing the part. We can also improve our clothing themselves by treating them with permethrin, which is a product that you can buy at the store, do it yourself, and that can last for 6 to 8 weeks. I'm sorry, 6 weeks or six washes, whichever comes first. Or you can buy pre-treated permethrin treated clothing, which lasts for about 90 washes. And we've blogged about this a lot, and Amara is going to put a link in to the chat that's going to bring you straight to all of the blogs where we talked about using permethrin to treat our clothing. So as I mentioned, there's lots of things that we can do. Those are just two. You can read about all of these strategies at our website, don'tgetticknY.org. The more strategies that you put into place, the less likely that tick is going to be able to embed, feed, and pass along its pathogens. So let's stay safe out there. Thanks.
Great job, Joellen. Again, you came right in under the wire and you communicated lots of terrific information. There were several questions that came in, but I think one of the points that people are most surprised about is that ticks are active through winter. So I don't know if you wanted to just briefly expand on tick activity throughout the year to indicate that, you know, when are ticks active?
Sure. Well, the black-legged ticks is the one that we're most concerned about, and they're found throughout New York State. So the eggs hatch in the summertime and they are active until they feed or until it gets too cold for them, but they can hunker down. I've actually found the larva in May. So these are very resilient critters. The ones that have fed in the springtime, they emerge as those poppy seed sized nymphs and they're active through the spring. And again, if the weather is conducive, they can remain active until it gets too cold. It's the adults They've got more energy, they're a larger size, and if it is above 37 degrees, they will be active throughout the winter. And not even 37 degrees air temperature, it's 37 degrees right where they are. So if you've got a nice, sunny, secluded spot, they can be there. I have been out in February on a brilliant 70 degree day, and I collected 43 adult ticks very, very quickly. So we're never really safe from ticks. Maybe hot, droughty summers is when we are the safest from black-legged ticks.
Thank you, Joellen, and thank you, Jody, for two great presentations today. We will be posting the recordings of these presentations to our YouTube channel. I will put that in the link. In the chat, excuse me. We do want to thank everyone for attending our presentations today, and we hope to see you at a future First Friday event. And that is all for today. So thank you very much.